Almost 30 million Americans will have an eating disorder in their lifetime. During the pandemic, the number of people seeking treatment has jumped. But as Amna Nawaz reports, eating disorders are often overlooked in people of color. A warning, this story discusses the behaviors associated with these conditions.
For years, Trey Brown hid her disordered eating from her family.
It's a stigma to have an eating disorder in my community. One of my cousins made the statement, Black people don't have eating disorders. That's a white person disease. We know how to eat.
When most people hear the phrase eating disorder, what do you think they picture? Who do they think of?
I think they picture a Caucasian female.
It's a widespread stereotype.
In my head, it's always like a white girl, like a young white girl.
In the media, it's always a thin, white, middle-class, upper-class woman.
But that's not the full picture, says researcher Karen Jennings Mathis.
The lifetime prevalence of any eating disorder among women of color is about the same or greater compared to white women.
And that could be an underestimate, since people of color are less likely than white people to have been asked by a doctor about eating disorder symptoms, says psychiatrist Erica Duraja.
Black women, for instance, are 25 to 40% less likely to be diagnosed with an eating disorder than white women. You may not necessarily even be screened for an eating disorder if you are a person of color.
Brown, now 36, has struggled with anorexia and bulimia since she was a teenager, but she's never gotten treatment.
You have insurance companies fighting you saying, oh, just eat. You have the doctors fighting you telling you, just eat. So it's really hard. It's extremely hard.
Do you think it was even harder for you because you're a Black woman?
Oh, of course. Matter of fact, I went to a doctor's appointment back in October. The doctor told me an eating disorder is not serious enough. And I said, so if I die, will it then be serious enough? They don't take African Americans serious.
Eating disorders are among the deadliest mental illnesses, causing over 10,000 deaths a year. Brown's eating disorder has taken an enormous toll on both her and her girlfriend, who didn't want to be identified.
She goes to support groups because of me, you know? And we've had very difficult conversations. She's like, I'm afraid I'm going to wake up and you're going to be dead. And I can't carry that on me, so I'm putting up my boundaries. My mental health has been affected because of your eating disorder.
Brown moved out of the apartment they shared. She dropped out of her PhD program. She stopped calling her 88-year-old grandmother, whom she used to talk to multiple times a day.
To me, eating disorder is like a whole nother person. And that person takes control over you. So that person will lie, manipulate, do whatever it is that it can do to keep that relationship and that bond with you. And that if that means tearing down relationships and dynamics between your family, your friends, your mate, your job, your school, it's going to do it.
The purposes and functions.
For
and
many,
outcomes.
The isolation and uncertainty of the pandemic worsened or even triggered their eating disorder. Sarah Molina was a thriving high school senior when COVID hit.
And then everything shut down. And it kind of felt like very like out of control, and then things just kept getting close for longer and longer and longer. And it was like, oh, maybe we'll graduate. Oh no, we're not graduating. Then it was like, oh, like our graduation might be like socially distanced. Then no, it was like a PowerPoint video.
Sports were also canceled.
I played softball since I was like 3 or 4, and it was my senior season and it was just starting, and then I never got to have it. And then also not being able to like exercise or like go out when like all that's like what I wanted to do.
So Molina controlled what she could, her eating. When she got to college, her anorexia became more serious.
I spent my 19th birthday starving myself.
She described how it ruined her birthday in a column she wrote for the Indiana Daily Student.
When we cut the cake, I had a piece. After all, it was my cake and my whole family was watching me. I took a bite and almost began to cry. It was a banana cake with white whipped cream frosting. It was one square piece of cake. Why was it so hard for me?
Molina knew she needed help.
I used to go on bike rides a lot or like runs or walks, and I couldn't do any of that stuff just because like my legs were so weak. And like I would notice when I was driving, like I would have to take breaks to pull over because like my hands and my legs were shaking so much, and like I couldn't find like the strength to like push down the pedal and stuff like that.
Her doctors recommended inpatient treatment, but most centers were full.
There were no spots open, and all the places we called, like, they would just be like, sorry, like, no, you can't come to this one.
Molina ultimately got treatment last summer. But as eating disorders spiked and medical admissions more than doubled in the pandemic, Dr. Duraja says the demand for help has far outstripped supply.
I don't know that we have enough resources or providers to actually meet the need, especially when we think about individuals experiencing eating disorders that are coming from different ethnic backgrounds, because we have to make sure that they are receiving appropriate and culturally appropriate care, and that's really, really hard to find.
Gloria Lucas runs a support group for those with eating disorders in communities of color, Nalgona Positivity Pride.
So what it means is that you're big booty positive.
Lucas sells merchandise on Etsy to raise awareness of people of color with eating disorders. Growing up the daughter of Mexican immigrants, she felt alone in her experience with binge eating and bulimia.
Throughout those years, there was no awareness of it, no doctor, my parents. It's challenging to hold those conversations. Especially when there's so much stigma on mental health, and then there's so much hatred towards fatness. And so it just makes that conversation, like, it's hard.
So Lucas started her own conversations. She posts regularly about positive body image and eating disorders to her 144,000 Instagram followers. But even with the support of her online community, the pandemic proved difficult.
The eating disorder got worse. I mean, I always say that eating disorders thrive in isolation. And the whole pandemic was people being isolated.
Lucas went to an outpatient program, which she says is a luxury.
I was only able to go to treatment because I was offered a scholarship. A lot of folks don't recognize that financial hardship that Black, Indigenous people of color experience, or low-income folks in general. And treatment is very expensive.
Lucas faced other barriers to treatment as well.
Sometimes you have to explain yourself more than one way. A lot of these treatment centers are not created with people like myself in mind. And what I mean by that is culturally affirming spaces rather than inclusive, right? Because the whole idea of inclusive is that there's already a standard.
Jennings Mathis has studied diversity in the eating disorder field.
The majority of individuals who are in this field do identify as white, and the majority are female. And so that may mean that individuals who have an eating disorder and who identify as a person of color may not feel like they fit within that community.
Trey Brown is trying to get her life back together.
Hello.
Hi, Grandma.
She recently called her grandmother for the first time in 2 months.
Well, it's been so long. Hallelujah, Jesus. Thank God.
Brown hopes to access treatment soon with the help of a nonprofit.
I want to be able to sit down with my family and enjoy a meal. You know, the last time I sat down with my family and ate a meal? 2009. I want to be able to do those things. And with this eating disorder, it's not possible unless I get help.
Brown and so many we spoke to for this story have a message for people of color out there who may be struggling. You are not alone. For the PBS NewsHour, I'm Amna Nawaz.
And if you or someone you know is struggling with an eating disorder, you can call the National Eating Disorders Helpline or get 24/7 crisis support by texting NEDA to 741-741.